So, a couple things on. I want to talk about the kind of the mindset pillar tonight, guys. I haven't been on in a while. Some of you that came on late. I want to hit a few things that came to mind for me. And it was sparked by a few things. You're going to see an email tomorrow. So please look at it. It's going to come out from us, the broadcast, about some things that I kind of, some ahas while I was away. But mixed into these two or three points I'm going to make is a book I invite you to write down. I asked Brett Gilliland a little while ago, what should I read next? He's in my, he kind of knows where I'm going with everything. He said, hey, what should I read next? The last thing on my mind that I thought he'd say is something to do with mindset. That's just not Brett's world. He's all about strategy and meeting flow and rhythm. He suggested I read a book called Mindset. It's by Dr. Carol Dweck, D-W-E-C-K. Lauren's shaking her head, so I don't even think we've talked about it, so that's awesome. It's the coolest book I've read in a long time on this subject. It's not like I go, yeah. It's intense. So I'm going to share some thoughts from it, and Lauren's going to chime in. But part of what I'm going to kind of weave into that this concept, and the concept that you'll see in the email is sort of, the book calls it a little different, but I call it simply open mindset versus closed mindset. Open versus closed. Quick example. Bill Reich goes through all that stuff he went through for challenges. Closed mindset, there's a million examples, but closed mindset could have easily been, I don't know how to do this, I guess, and label himself and shut down. Instead, he trudged through with, like, it's an understatement to say he gritted through that with an open mindset and kept learning. And guess what? Paydays in excess of $250,000 in the last 3 or 4 days. Okay, it works. This stuff works. Secondly, I think I've told many of you, Kim and I closed on a piece of land up in Stowe. It wasn't to tell you that we did that to say, look at us. It was to say, that was a 30-year goal. Were there some things along the way in the last 30 years that got in the way? Yeah, Nick's here. Nick had an accident in 03. 08, you all know about. Like, there was a lot of shit that got in the way, right, along the way. So it's about keeping that, whatever it is for you, I don't know what everyone's is, but keeping that clearly in sight and understanding that all the stuff that happens along the way does not define you by any means. And still, regardless of the struggle, strive for it. Because as I look at my notes when I was up there, like, there was nothing, as bad as it was for some of the stuff we went through, nothing was disastrous, nothing was death, nothing was like earth shattering. So just keep that, and this is all mindset. And I'm gonna give Laura some ammo here. I know she's gonna wanna chime in here. When I say labels, I said Bill could have labeled himself. Some of us were labeled when we were younger, weren't we? I'm certain some of us were. So I was in reading class. I've told that story a lot to some of you guys have been around. When I was in junior high, I put that on myself. I said, oh, that must be kind of where I live. So I'm not saying I'm immune to this either. We all go through it. But a closed-minded person says, I guess that's me. I'm done. And an open-minded says, that's me in this little slot, in this compartment. I'm going to learn. I'm going to strive past that. A couple of things came to mind when I was reading this. I thought this was really cool. When you talk about kind of testing yourself and all these bumps we can go through, NASA, and I never read this before, NASA picks the astronauts based on failures. They don't pick someone that had no failures. They want multiple failures. That's the person they want to be at the helm. Jack Welch came up in the book. He, as a CEO, and you guys, there's books and books and books on him. As a CEO, he only picked people with the capacity for growth. So that open mindset, not I got what I got. I was born with it. Whatever, my parents, all those things. He looked for someone that had the growth mindset and had a lot of trajectory left, or he wouldn't even hire him. And I could go on and on. The examples are amazing. So if you think about successful people, well, let me change that. Exceptional people in general, they convert all these setbacks like Bill did. And I'm using Bill a lot tonight for that, but they convert all these setbacks to massives, not just little, massive success. That's pretty cool. Lauren, I'm going to take a little breath there. I got a bunch of examples, but do you have any thoughts? Because I saw you shaking your head a bunch of times.
Yeah, Carol Dweck, she's awesome. So she has a great TED Talk also. She's not the most enthralling speaker, but the content is awesome. You can just look her up. I forgot what it's called. I think it's called maybe The Power of Yet. Anyway, I don't know if she talked, I don't remember if she talked about that in the book, but her, something she emphasizes is how powerful the word yet is. And think about it, right? We have, I'm not putting any of our students on blast, but students that say, I haven't gotten it taken. Okay, now add the word yet at the end of that sentence and that changes the whole entire tone. It, you know, when you have such a definitive statement, you put a period at the end of the sentence, you know, sometimes people feel hopeless or, you know, stressed out or worthless or less than, and the list goes on. You add the word yet to the end of that sentence and the entire thing changes. All you have to remember is, I haven't gotten fill in the blank here yet, or I haven't accomplished blank yet. You know, so her TED talk will talk a lot about that and a bunch of research that she did with inner city kids and how they were labeled, you know, and they were the lowest in the state. I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but anyway, it ended up, they did a bunch of things and ended up working out really well. So I highly recommend anything that she's written as well.
And I mix it in, guys. I like when I went to Stowe, I brought mindset, but I also brought other books. I on purpose just mix it in just so you don't think you got to be like, get all of a sudden become mm-hmm. this mindset master. So I wrote down a couple other things, Lauren, we'll keep following. I got a couple, I'll share my second. I have 3 points about the whole land thing we did up there. So I wrote down open mindset, are concerned with one thing, constantly improving. Whereas closed mindset's more, I'm concerned with how I am judged and all those limitations. And I can, again, give a million examples, but the second piece I want to weave in here to what we did for the after the 30 years of waiting on that goal was Brian Tracy said in the interview, I hope you all saw it by now, if it didn't come out, it'll come out soon, but the video's already went out. And he talked about that 7-year thing that I brought up at BSS, that all of us will go through this 7-year cycle as an entrepreneur. So we're hitting that 7th year in Smart Coach, thereabouts. But what about all the other 7-year cycles that were for the last 30 years? They were learning years. So I just encourage you to keep that. This is nothing more than a reminder tonight. There's nothing new I'm saying to you guys tonight. Nothing more than a reminder to become just like this constant learner. There was another cool story in the book. It talked about Mia Hamm, and it talked about how as kids we might've been labeled, or as adults we might've been labeled, and how the exposure really does matter. You guys have heard me say exposure matters all the time. But what Mia Hamm would do to get better and better and better, and we're coming up to a Summer of Deals event where you can do some of this, not personally, but in business. Mia Hamm would play soccer with like the next best, you know, male player on the in the elementary or high school. Then she'd go up to her brothers. Then she'd go up to college. She would just keep pushing the exposure bucket and get better and better and better. And look what happened to her. So all that to say, you're in the community. You got the right thing going on here. But how about you push the envelope a little bit on that and make sure you're at Summer of Deals. Make sure you're talking to the people that are capping out. Make sure you're talking to people that aren't stumbling as much and stumbling as much so you can learn from them. This is all going on in the community, but just reach out. Brian, how many calls, I don't want to invite calls to you necessarily, but how many calls do you get a week from this community for, you know, personal help or development? I'm picking on you, but any high six could answer this.
It's several. I mean, 2 to 3.
Okay, but that's tiny.
What's up?
I said that's tiny. So
right.
You guys, I'm not saying pick up the phone and call Brian tomorrow. All the high six here. I'm not saying call them. I am saying network more. You have all the answers right here, mindset and skill set and system wise. So that's the second piece, not giving up on the goal, paying attention to the 7-year cycle. Third is celebrating the wins. How we chose to do it with the land is we brought family up there. One of our goals, you guys know now at our stage, is to just create experiences for family. So we brought family up there. We let them share in the win. They've been putting up with it, you know. So share the wins with your family. Brian took his family while we were in Stowe to Mexico. Coolest trip, right, Brian?
We did not take our son. Well, I just want to correct that.
Yeah, you did that before that trip. You took
two. He's not allowed. Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, I was texting Brian while he was there saying, when you buying it? And we were brainstorming that as we go. That's all for a reason. Like, that's fun stuff we all should do. And then celebrate that win with family. And doesn't matter, the whole family was there. He celebrated that win. And I don't know if you booked your trip. I'll put you on the spot and ask you, did you book next year's trip like I said?
I did not. So you can put me on the spot. But we are going to. We just need to figure out the dates. And it's because of my son's school, because we're going to take him. So.
All right, I'll let that slide. Make sure you get a book. I'm going to ask everyone, ask Brian in the next 3 months, did you book the trip to Mexico? A little accountability. Lauren, anything else on open closed mindset in general? I know, well, you could talk 2 hours on it, but any thoughts for tonight for these guys?
Yeah, I just to add a little bit more too. So with the growth or the open mindset that we're talking about, so you have to, people with that mindset are open to feedback and they're open to constructive criticism. So that is the only way that we learn. you know, and failure should be seen. Well, first of all, don't even get me started on that, because I don't even believe that it exists. I mean, unless you quit, and then maybe, yeah. But a lot of people think, well, you know, I haven't gotten something yet, so that means I failed, or that means I'm a failure. Anyway, that is really the only thing that teaches us, and that's really the best way that we learn. So people with that type of mindset actually welcome it. And, you know, it's not something that holds you back. You know, it's okay, what did I learn from this? How can I move forward from this? I just learned, you know, a bunch of ways not to do something. It's not something that, you know, becomes you as a person, which I think a lot of us do as high achievers. We can take things that don't go the way that we want them to go, and we personalize it and internalize it. And that can really harm us emotionally, I mean, and mentally. So I think the importance of being open to feedback is going to be critical. Sometimes, a lot of times, a lot of new students think they're bugging us, or they're embarrassed to send us calls. We've talked about this many, many times. And they comb through all of their calls and send us the best one that they think it is, instead of just sending us a shit ton of calls that they've done. You know, like, what's the point? There's no point in trying to pick the best one when, you know, you're just starting. Like, we're all terrible when we first start, and that's fine. You know, just so I think basically just being open to feedback and not feeling like you're intruding on anybody. You deserve to be here, you know, just like the rest of us deserve to be here. There's no intrusion. You're here to learn. We're here to help. And the only way to get better is to send us stuff, have it critiqued, and then put it into action.
And Lauren, in addition to that, we all are going to hit, when you hit the, like some of the sliding or the errors that Bill went through, that we've definitely gone through. Don't label yourself there and say, you screwed up, therefore you don't know how to do it. Every single one of us have done it. And Cammie and Greg gave me permission to talk with them there. They couldn't be on. I said, I want you to talk with us tonight. They said, we're not going to be on. So I was on my way to an appointment this morning, and we did our quick accountability call from the car instead of Zoom. I do that like 2 or 3 times a week with them, despite them being in a group coaching. And last night, the text was, have you ever had a problem with a shared driveway? And I said, of course, call me in the morning. Like, there's almost no problems that you guys can hit, almost, with few exceptions, that we haven't hit personally ourselves. And so we walked through that. And I said, how do you feel now compared to this curveball coming at you, say, 6 months ago? And she said, night and day. I used to panic. And she did. She used to freak out when there's a problem, thinking it was new. It's not new. And every call we get off with her, I say, now you're that much better as a coach and that much better as an investor. And she's just like, celebrates it now. Totally different. So your mindset has to be, these things are going to happen. It's real estate. Here's the comment she made that she wanted me to share. She said, yes, it's real estate. Yes, there's problems. But Chris, our upside is so ridiculously high, we have to expect that. And that's a cool attitude to have. Because when you talk about paydays, we're low, but our paydays are 75 grand and up. Bills are whatever, 90 to 190. When you have that kind of a payday, expect some challenges, for goodness sakes. It's not going to cakewalk. So...